question session.
Okay, and we are recording.
Okay, so we're here tonight to talk about Veneur, which is a metrics aggregation thing. Very similar to StatsD, if you're familiar with StatsD. It was basically, well, there's a story, so I won't go into that. I'm Corey. This is not me, but the clip art looked better than me. And so I left it in because I wrote this talk Thursday night, and I thought that this would be better than showing you a real picture of me. I only have one kid, but anyway, I work at Stripe. I'm the lead for the observability team, and I already talked about the clip art. All right, great. So, Stripe and observability. We use Datadog. I did a talk last year at a couple of different places where I talked about how observability became a thing at Stripe and how we changed culture such that people didn't do silly things in production, or if they did, they at least knew about it. And so I had a slide at the beginning that was like, this isn't a technical talk, so let's get all the technical stuff out of the way. But tonight, this is a technical talk, actually, but it's mostly about the plumbing, not about the things on the two ends. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the things on the two ends. Specifically for our observability stack, we use Datadog, we use Splunk, we use Sentry, and probably some other things. But my team predominantly runs these three things within Stripe. Previously, before the Datadog stuff came into place, we used Grafana, Graphite, StatsD. Pretty standard stuff, probably not a shocker for anybody, things that we probably are using or have used in the past. So, the old world and what things were like back then. So this is basically the old world, which is probably a year and a half, about a year and a half. We used Graphite, and Graphite, as you're probably all familiar, uses dotted names. So how many of us are Graphite people or have used Graphite in the past and know a thing or two about Graphite? Great. We had some problems with it. Not all these problems were because Graphite is bad. Like, we did not have ownership of the observability stack within Stripe. It was just whoever happened to be in the neighborhood that week, whoever lost the lottery to fix Graphite that particular week, right? And so there were a lot of problems. Namely, like a new metric, if you put something into production and you had a metric, it would take sometimes like 15 minutes for the metric to even show up for graphing purposes, which was very painful. And you may not know, like, did my thing work? Is my code actually here? This doesn't inspire confidence. All of the sort of plumbing and how this stuff was strapped together was very creaky and very poorly understood. Again, not the fault of the stack, a lack of investment on our part. Lastly, StatsD, how many of you are using or have used StatsD somewhere in the past? Great. So you probably know all about trying to send lots of UDP packets to one machine. It doesn't always work. And when it stops working, it sometimes starts like a trickle, and you're like, oh, that's no big deal, and then one day it gets really bad because you're dropping a lot. When I joined Stripe, they were sort of like kind of knew they were dropping packets, but they were dropping about 50% of the packets, which, you know, if you're working with counters and stuff, you sort of, like, why are you even doing it anymore? Like, you're clearly not adding up to the right numbers. And this is bad. So we had some problems we needed to solve. And we did so pretty much by switching to use Datadog. Anybody a Datadog user, perchance? Cool. So Datadog, again, this is not because they are better than anything. It's just newer. More modern and updated tools. We were having a conversation earlier about Grafana. Like, Grafana, we were using Grafana, but it was a really, really old version. And any of you who have used an old version of Grafana know it wasn't that great many years ago. Now it's really good, but we weren't keeping up with it. Specifically with Datadog, actually, I should probably give maybe a little backstory. I used Datadog at the job I had before I worked at Stripe. And then the job before that, I worked for Twitter, where we did observability in-house, and it was all custom-built stuff. So I have been on that end of running an in-house custom time series database and all custom stack. And so I didn't want to do that again. I knew that much. And so I basically wanted to pay somebody else to do it. So we decided to use Datadog. So since there was only one other Datadog user, I'll tell you a little bit about DogStatsD. This link, which if you just search for DogStatsD, you'll find this link. You don't have to use my link. But DogStats, how many of us are approximately familiar? Like, how many of you could write a StatsD line from memory? That's a pretty good ratio. It's not that bad. It's basically a metric name, and then a colon, and then a number, and then a pipe, and then a character, right? Or maybe two characters if it happens to be a timer, which is an MS, which doesn't mean it's milliseconds, though. Super weird. So DonkStatsD is basically a superset. It's more features added on top of StatsD. It's still UDP. It's still text-based protocol. But it uses tags instead of dotted names. And it's also got some other primitives in addition to just metrics. Actually, I think I have slides for this. I've only practiced this talk once, so I'm probably going to talk about a slide that I haven't shown yet. Specifically, though, Datadog runs a version of the DogStatsD server on every machine in your fleet. So when you run StatsD, as you're probably all familiar, you run a StatsD. Or maybe if you're super fancy, you run like a sharded StatsD with smart clients or something, or maybe a StatsD proxy, or maybe something really fancy. How many of you are familiar with Brubeck? So Brubeck is a C-based implementation of StatsD that's way faster. The StatsD is written in Node, is that right?
It's Node, right?
Okay. It's JavaScript, I knew that much. Which is great until it gets to really, really high levels of incoming packets, and then it just sort of kind of falls off. And so the folks at GitHub wrote Brubeck, which is a C implementation of StatsD, and DogStatsD that is conveniently shipped with the agent to install on every Datadog machine is written in Python. Now, again, it's fine until it isn't, and then you sort of hit this really bad drop-off where you start to drop packets, and you start to burn a ton of CPU. That's another thing that people notice pretty fast. So we got some cool upsides from this. The convenient host local stuff, like this solves a scaling problem, right? Because all your metrics are now coming just on the host. So it's a lot easier to spray UDP packets, first off, from one machine to itself, and also on the loopback device. And there's also not mysterious MTU problems anymore because your loopback MTU is really big. Anyway, minutia about StatsD, which I'm going to get probably even worse into later. But we also got rid of all the drops because we were no longer spraying the entire fleet's concentrated UDP particle beam at one poor nick. We're doing it across, like, say, you know, all these machines and sending them out. But I think the next slide is maybe what went wrong. Oh, no, it's not. It's what this is. We talked about some of this. So StatsD and tags. How many of you are using something that's tag-based for metrics now? Cool. So pretty decent mix. So if you're not familiar, if you're used to the Graphite thing, or things like Graphite, Graphite's got sort of a hierarchical naming system, right? You have to sort of design a schema, if you will, in your dotted name so that you know kind of what everything's going to be. If you want racks to be a part of that, you've got to get that in there, and then the position in the rack needs to also be part of the dotted name. And if you don't ever change that, because if you ever change it, you now have to change all your wildcards and all this other stuff. Tags are basically take the slimmest part of the name, like maybe requests, or maybe service name dot requests total or something like that, and that's your counter name. And then your tags are then a non-hierarchical form of just adding tags onto every metric. So you can put your rack as a tag, and you can put your rack position as a tag or something like that. And then you would query for it hierarchically, maybe by just saying, give me the rack, or you can do it across all the racks by saying, give me position 4. It's flexible and causes less trouble than changing your schema names, but if you happen to have a really well thought out schema in your dotted names and you've already done that, then maybe not such a big deal. DogStatsD also has some other primitives. If you've ever used the event stuff maybe in Grafana to overlay your deploys as part of your charts or something like that, like that's an event typically, that's something that's supported by DogStatsD and flows into Datadog. There's also service checks, which are sort of like the output of a Nagios check, like okay, not okay, stuff like that. You can send all that along to Datadog also. But there's some problems with this, specifically this host local thing. When we started to run Datadog, before that we were sending, so you've got a metric that's like the time it took for someone to complete a transaction on your website, hopefully measured in some small unit, like so you send a metric, and they all go to this one StatsD instance, which now has this big, long list of every transaction that's occurred in the last flush period, say 10 seconds. So if you want to calculate a percentile from that, that's very easy. We all learned how to do this in C++. see how old's my daughter. She just brought this homework home recently, and I was like, I have feels about how you're doing aggregation. But anyway, that's easy to do. We've got the full list of everything. We can just go, here's the median, here's the 99th percentile, and all these other things. That's super easy to do. Well, in Datadog's world, we only have the metrics that were sent to the local machine, which means if I want to see the percentile, I can only get it for every host in my fleet individually. So if I've got 100 boxes running my API, I now have 100 different P99s for this one operation I perform. Okay, well, I mean, I guess you could average your percentiles across hosts, or max them or min them, but for any of you who actually know anything about math, which is probably a lot more than I do, I do know that that's not really a useful way to view percentile. A lot of people get by with it, though, honestly, which is kind of weird. But averaging your P99 does show you something. I'm not sure how useful it is, but it does show you something. We also lost sets for the same reason. So how many of you use sets with StatsD? So very few people seem to use this very much, but a set in StatsD, if you're not familiar with it, is like for every error that occurs, I want to count how many unique merchants saw that error. And so you get this count at the end that says seven people saw this error, or one person saw this error. And it's a good indicator because you can use this to see like the breadth of a problem or something like that. But we lost it because we only had the host local set. We could only say how many times it happened on this box. And then furthermore, we would be combining them. We don't know if the same merchant had this happen on every box or if it was a different merchant on every box. And lastly, I mentioned this is the same with StatsD or with DogStatsD. We ended up with, we had one set of boxes that ran Storm, and like every bolt in Storm emitted metrics, and that really quickly burned like all the CPU on the box. Like we were running really high load averages because it was not too high of a load average because it basically just ate one core, but still, it was not able to really keep up with the load. So Datadog was cool, and this was all nice to have, but suddenly, like as we were sort of, our process for adopting Datadog was to basically run them side by side. We dual published all of our metrics. And so the engineers were like, wow, this interface is really great. I can see so much cool stuff. Where did all my percentiles go? Stuff like this. And this was really important because Stripe works very hard to keep those reasonable. And so we wanted to make sure that anybody who happens to be a Stripe customer, if you're in the room, we wanted your API calls to still be fast. And we wanted to prove that that was actually the case. So we needed to make a thing. I am being cool and pretending like we wrote requirements first because that's what we're supposed to do. We didn't really. There's a story for that later, but I'll go ahead and tell you the requirements we have now, which was that, first off, host-local stuff was like actually really convenient. We really like this model of not running a central machine that aggregates all metrics. The operational story there was very good. Scaling it was easier for us if we didn't have this problem. We must, though, have some form of global percentiles. We needed to know across the entire fleet what did this look like. I mean, otherwise, why are you using percentiles? Like, they're a very valuable way to measure latency or whatever else, sometimes the bodies of requests or whatever if you use it as a histogram. And lastly, we wanted it to be compatible with Datadog. Like, I had come into Stripe and been like, we're totally going to do this. We're going to move. And I didn't want to have to move to something else. So we probably wanted to keep it Datadog compatible. Sort of loosely, and I hinted at this earlier if you happened to be in the room, but part of it was also to sort of hedge against the idea that we wouldn't want to be completely tied to Datadog forever. There's a possibility that DogStatsD, which I think is a reasonable extension of the StatsD protocol, especially if you're working with a tag-based thing like OpenTSDB, Influx, like all these newer time series databases all use the same sort of thing. Prometheus is also tag-based, but it's pull instead of push model, but you can still make it work. All of these things were basically the requirements that I am retconning into this process to make it look like there was So, enter Veneur. So first off, what is Veneur? What is this goofy name? So, secondly, the people that founded Datadog were the CTO and the CEO are both French. And so I have this weird branding thing where any of my open source projects all have to be named after a title. It's just because, I mean, naming things is hard. So Veneur was the title given to the Master of Hounds for like the royalty when they would go out and go hunting or whatever. The dude that took care of all the dogs was his title. So the Hound Master was where that came from.
And the real answer as to how Veneur came into existence was that Go seemed pretty cool, and I'd written some stuff in it, but I hadn't really written anything in anger. So I was like, yeah, I totally am going to build a better stats D. There was a lot of hubris. I was like, right, Go routines? Like, I can totally make something that's way better than stats D. It'll be able to process like a million packets a second, and I will be lauded forever on the internet for having saved stats D. I don't know why. So Brubeck is C-based and is very fast and can handle a lot of packets, but it's not DogStatsD. And DogStatsD is, the tag-based system. So I wanted something that was basically Brubeck, but for DogStatsD, and I wanted to write it in Go. So we basically just started off with, I'm going to make a faster StatsD. And here, is there anything else I want to say about this? So I basically started hacking on this in the evenings, just sort of like, how does Go work and trying to make it do things. I'll probably spend some time later. I can talk a smidge about how to process lots of UDP packets. The answer on normal AWS instances is don't. But you can, if you add more ENIs, you can make them faster. Or if you happen to not run virtual machines, you can make them very fast. You can turn on RPS and all kinds of other fun stuff. But if anybody wants to nerd out about packets, I can do that too. So here are some things we got out of it. So Datadog versus StatsD. So Veneur now does exist. Veneur is in production in Stripe running everything, basically. There are a few other companies that are evaluating it who have not gotten permission to talk about who they are, but they are looking at it. They may or may not adopt it. Some have, some haven't. But what did we get? First off, it was written in Go. We find it, for reasons I will explain later, and also just the nature of Go itself, to be very fast and to consume relatively small amounts of memory, which is awesome, and also relatively small amounts of CPU. We also, because we were talking about, so if you're working in a situation where you have a lot of requests happening, if you've got tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions, whatever requests per second, that's a lot of timers to keep up with to build a histogram. You have to keep every one of them if you want this to work. So we decided to go for approximate histograms and also approximate sets, which we'll talk more about in a bit. It also is fully compatible with Datadog's magic tags. Since only very few of us in this room happen to be Datadog customers, it doesn't mean anything to you, but there are basically a few tags that you can apply that influence how the metric works downstream. You can override a couple of things, so all that stuff is completely compatible and works. Also, if you've used StatsD, familiar with the distinction between retaining versus not retaining at a flush, does that mean anything to anybody in the room? So you can adjust StatsD such that if I've got a counter called like Corey.awesome things he's done, then every time, I send a couple of metrics, it flushes it, and then it either chooses to ditch it at that point and never emit it again unless you send a metric, or it will start emitting zeros for some period thereafter. That's a really nice convenience feature for some dashboards or monitoring systems because they need those zeros to sort of tell that the metric's either present or not present. That is an option in StatsD. It is an option in Datadog's implementation of StatsD, DogStatsD. It is not an option in Veneur. It will not emit metrics after a flush period. I will explain more about why. By the way, you can totally stop me at any point if you have any questions about any of this. Please feel free to just jump right in. So I want to talk a bit about smart compliance. So there was a bunch of StatsD hands that went up. Are any of you doing anything fancy to shard your StatsD? So if you ever decide you need to, one way you can do that is by running multiple StatsD instances and saying, like, everything, I embarrassingly do not know what the 13th letter of the alphabet is, but anything A to the 13th letter, then the 13th letter to Z, like, split them 50-50 and send these to StatsD and this to StatsD 1 versus 2 or something like that. You can do it that way. We tried that. In fact, the way that we originally tried to run Veneur was we left the local StatsD instances there, and then we put Veneur sitting in the center where StatsD was and said, take all the timers and the sets that need to be global and route those to the global StatsD, everything else just send that to the local. And we built that into the client. Stripe is a monolith, and it
There's like a handful of things that were written as separate gems. It's all Ruby shop. And then the monolith is like this thing that imports these gems. And so every time we came up with a new cool idea, or mostly found a new bug, we had to repackage that gem, redo everything, and then roll the entire fleet. It was this giant pain. In fact, we had two different statsd connections that we kept open, and then we had the logic to just jump between, well, if it's this type, if it's that type, rather than the two places. We made a ton of infrastructure for this, and we started to get really fancy. Like, well, if this tag is here, then we'll start. This was a slow descent into madness, and I do not recommend building smart. Yes?
The other reason why this is bad is because there are a lot of open source projects that support statsd natively, and you have no control over their capability.
That is a great point. Thank you for saying that, because I didn't think about that at the time. We're very polyglot. And so we had like Ruby, JVM, Python. You have sometimes things like, there is a fairly strong feature within Stripe that literally uses netcat to get a metric into statsd. Like, the beauty of statsd is that it is such a simple protocol, and it is so easy to wire something up. You can cap things into dev UDP if you want to. Like, it's that easy to construct. That's also where the majority of your shitty string bugs come from that break your statsd decoder, which we found trying to write our own statsd implementation. But this is just like, you end up having to maintain so many. If you work in a monoglot or mono language environment where you can just like build this one single way to do it, then it might work well for you. But it didn't for us, even for our predominantly Ruby code base. We just found too often we needed to make significant changes to the way that the routing worked, which we had to then do in the application, which was not a good one for us. So this is where you now imagine the nope, nope, nope octopus going across the screen, because that's how I feel about it. Some other really novel features about the way that the there's diagrams in a bit to help with this. So one of the problems with statsd is that it ingests all these packets and then it has to stop to then take all these packets and process them and then ship them out. And so in that very, very brief period, your receive buffer will fill up and you will start to drop packets. This is a very common problem. We take only the tiniest pause to do this, and we could probably eliminate it. But basically, we allocate the data structure to hold these things, and the only pause we take is to swap pointers. So we have to lock it long enough to make that move. Recently, we got a feature to add TCP support, which some statsd implementations use. The benefit to statsd generally is that it's very fire and forget. But it's also fire and might not make it there. So for some people, that's not appropriate, and they instead would prefer to use TCP, and furthermore, they might even want to use TLS so that they can end-to-end encrypt their metrics. We do not use this. Stripe definitely does not put anything money-related into any of these, so we consider them to mostly be fine. So we do not use this, but thanks to Evan Jones and BlueCore for contributing that. We also have some features that let you like dump everything to S3 if your environment can do that. We did it for a while with the intent of loading it into Redshift and then had some other problems that made us get rid of it. You can also tee all your metrics out to just the local file on the disk, which is pretty fun to do some interesting side projects with. It's also very heavily instrumented. The guy that stepped out is from Lyft, and they have a line on Envoy, their internal routing layer, that says best-in-class observability. I like to think that my observability-based server is best-in-class observability, too. I wanted to steal that line, but credit to them. But a lot of it's got built-in Go profiling support. Like, if you want to determine why in your environment it's maybe using too much CPU, or if it's using memory, or GC pauses, or whatever it is, we have full profiling all built in. It's all enabled with a config flag. So you can totally look into all that and look at fancy flame graphs and stuff. Also, outputs a lot of metrics. So the Veneur then shifted at this point, because we've taken this, like, we've basically reproduced the statsd world. We've got the centralized Veneur instance, and we've got all these local dog statsd agents that are just shipping their metrics out to Datadog themselves. But the smart client thing was not working well for us. What we wanted to do was adjust Veneur itself to forward and merge. We wanted the local machine to receive its metrics, and then it should make the routing decision. It should become the smart client. But this is tricky, because then we needed to also make our histograms mergeable. because if we were going to collect those metrics locally, then we had to take its histogram, send that downstream, and then bring all the histograms together and give you a real one in the end. Same for sets. We had to come up with some way to make that work. And the fun side of this, though, is that basically DogStatsD would go away. Because remember I said earlier, we got these local instances. They're receiving a ton of metrics. They're burning a lot of CPU. My users, so the way we're positioned internally, the observability team, even though we outsource some of this to people like Datadog, we still treat everyone internally as if they're observability's customers. So you don't go to Datadog and complain, you come to us, we take care of that for you. Sometimes we build stuff like this to route around it, sometimes we just open a ticket with Datadog, but either way, the buck stops with us. And so we needed to fix this because some people were coming to us and saying, I've got this instance, but you're burning like a whole core just processing my metrics. So we need to make that better. So we ended up, there's probably, that's where that slide was that I said I didn't know why it was in here. It should have been in between these two instead of a few later. So now what we've got is we've got this one instance that's acting in the center, and then all the local instances are collecting their metrics and forwarding them downstream. The problem, though, there's a couple of downsides. The first is everyone who uses StatsD is familiar that it aggregates metrics for, say, 10 seconds and then flushes metrics out, so you get 10-secondly metrics. Using this second layer of Veneur adds a second 10-second delay. So for anything that is forwarded to the global, you then now have a 20-second delay waiting for your histograms to come out the other side. The global is also, just like StatsD, a bit of a single point of failure, because if you lose that instance, then you lose your timers and your sets or whatever else. But it's an interesting failure mode, because it sort of degrades, right? Because it's like, well, I lost all my timers, but my counters still work. All my counters and my gauges and stuff are still functioning, which is kind of interesting. It doesn't completely fail. You also can't really load balance it, because if you forward to a server, that same server must receive all packets to be able to generate that centralized histogram. But because of the 10-second thing, it's only stateful for 10 seconds. So after 10 seconds, I can send it to whatever other host I want. So that's kind of an interesting thing. Although, I'm not going to bother to point out the tag interpolation thing, because that's a Datadog thing, and only Fred and I would be interested in it. Some fun stuff that happened. So, StatsD, as everyone knows, takes this big thing and, like, you know, poops all these metrics out to Graphite or whatever. That's what we did in our first version of Veneur. We sent all the metrics to this one machine, and then we took this one giant post body and just sent it all to Datadog at once. We didn't really denial of service attack them, but they were not particularly happy about it, because the way that Datadog works is it's host local, so there are, like, you know, millions of machines around the internet that are sending them these small HTTP posts, and we sent them a 45 megabyte post body, and they were like, hey, Corey, how's it going? Would you stop? And I'm like, yeah, sure, I'll stop. And they're like, by the way, you could, what actually happened is we sent it, and then one day it just stopped working. And they noticed it, and we noticed it, and so we started comparing notes. And it turns out that this is why I now know that Datadog has a 42 megabyte post body limit, because we, like, hit this threshold and got up into the 45 range. And they're like, well, but you can compress it. And I'm like, God, why were we not compressing it? Like, that's kind of stupid. So then we compressed it down, and then it was down 7 megabytes. But it turns out that their check is post-decompressed, so it still broke. Anyway, another thing that that Veneur does, which I don't know that I highlighted here, but the way we got around this, Veneur actually has a configurable counter or a configurable threshold that you set, and actually breaks the post body up into, you know, however many smaller requests it needs, and then just sprays them all at Datadog sort of together, which is very well within the way they expect you to function. But it ends up sort of like simultaneously doing dozens of post requests, however many it needs, and that's totally adjustable through. So you don't have to send 45 megabyte post bodies. So some fancy buzzwords we're going to talk about now about how Veneur works. Metric routing and how it moves things around itself and its minions. Approximate streaming percentiles. Also, if you're playing buzzword bingo tonight, you can check hyper log log off. Part of why I think I did this project was to get the act of saying I have used a hyper log log in production. The first implementation was the other one, now I'm going to forget the name of, but the other thing that you do with digest to try to get compute. I figures I'm being recorded and I can't remember the name of that thing now. We'll come back to it when I remember. So approximate percentiles. Anybody heard of T-Digest before? Looked into this stuff? So there are a number of ways to do approximate percentiles. Reservoir sampling is another common mechanism for this. That's actually the one that Veneur used in the original case. There is a professor by the name of Dunning who published a paper on something called T-Digest, which is his approximate percentile implementation for doing streaming percentiles. It's pretty cool. It's all on GitHub. You can go look at the implementation. It's, if you understand math stuff, I'm sure you can figure it out. I had an intern by the name of Steven, who is he's mentioned right there, Tummy Chow on GitHub. So basically, we looked at T-Digest, and it was really great, and said, this sounds like it's something that would work for us. So we wrote a custom implementation of T-Digest in Go and made it part of Veneur, which you can see at, I put it out there. I thought it was interesting in hindsight to look at this as the series of commits that we did into Veneur to make this stuff work. So the original version used a reservoir sampling thing that, I don't know, I think I might have used Go metrics implementation actually in my first version. But since then we switched over to T-Digest. So the reason that this kind of stuff is cool, T-Digest specifically uses a fixed amount of memory. So for every individual histogram that you create, so if you send one histogram, it's a fixed amount of memory. If you send 10 of them, it's 10 times that, right? So this is really great because in something like StatsD, the more metrics you send, it becomes basically an O of N problem. Like the more times you calculate, or the more timers you send, packets of timers you send, the bigger it gets, and it will eventually consume all of your memory and melt your machines or something like that, right? So this is not something we have to deal with anymore. And then, furthermore, in addition to just having this nice streaming approximate histogram, by the way, this pull request may have links to some cool documentation on, like, us actually graphing out the errors and, like, what the approximation looks like. Specifically, T-Digest errors toward, I say this down at the bottom, it's basically reduced error at the edges. It's a little, like, iffy about stuff in the dead center because you typically don't care about median. You typically want to see what your P99s and stuff on the very, very edge of your graph of your timers look like. And so that's where it errors to. There's a lot of information in these pull requests that you can look at if you're interested. But in even cooler than Dunning's original implementation, we actually improved his implementation. Well, it depends on your measure of improve, but for us, we liked it. Ours is just a little bit slower, but uses half again the memory that the original does, because all of our updates are in place. So whenever you create these histograms, basically you allocate a bunch of preordained number of buckets, and then you start to bucket similarly, range times within these buckets or what have you. And so our implementation no longer requires you to allocate two versions and merge them together, sort of zip them together. We basically do them all in place. So it lowers GC pressure because you create a lot less stuff, but it runs a little bit slower. It was about 50% all said and done in terms of how slow the merges were, but we only do that once every 10 seconds for like each timer, so it turned out to net out in a win for us. But basically this is like, I mean, I'm not an expert on these things, but it's a pretty state-of-the-art streaming approximate histogram implementation, and I'm very proud that I have such an awesome team that can take the terrible thing I made and turn it into something like really great. And interestingly, Steven that did this implementation actually gave an incredibly good talk to all of us, especially for people like me who are not math awesome. He did a really good job of explaining how it worked. And so the fact that I'm able to explain it to you tonight is basically all his fault. So T-Digest is pretty cool, and we're using it every day for all of our timers, and we're very happy with it. Hyperlog logs, what is that other hash implementation for doing counts of things? I forget this every time I practice this talk. Bloom filter, it's right there, I wrote it, yay. So, bloom filters, I got to check that off my list, is actually using bloom filters in production once in my life. So hyperlog logs are another way of taking a whole bunch of occurrences of something and counting the unique ones in the set. So the very loose implementation, I don't know a lot about hyperlog logs, but I do know bloom filters, which is that basically you allocate a whole bunch of bits, and whenever a value comes in, you hash it, and you sort of do it like modulus, where you like flip the bits on for that, and then if that one comes back, you can tell that you did it because you turned all the same bits on. So it's a fixed memory implementation of determining how many unique things have happened in a set. It does have errors to it. But generally speaking, especially for larger values, it pays off because it's a fixed amount of memory. And you don't have to keep every single one of them. So it's pretty great. We were able to use these. But we don't really use sets that often. But we do have hyperlog logs, which is good for buzzword bingo. Okay, I apologize that all my little arrows don't line up. I did this on the plane today. I don't live in San Francisco. I'm from Nashville, Tennessee. And I did this on the plane, and for some reason, like, Keynote won't let you line them all up. So this infuriated me, but we'll work with what we got. So I probably should have moved this up and shown this earlier in the talk, so forgive me for only now showing you the diagram. But this is basically StatsD. This is the implementation you're all used to if you're running StatsD today. You've got a whole bunch of hosts that are all spraying their metrics via UDP to one host. We did this too for a while, but this was basically StatsD, but as dog StatsD. Veneur will work for that. In fact, we originally built it for this, but making one box do this was very, very hard. You very quickly run out of a lot of things. You run out of packet buffers on a lot of levels. If you've ever tried to determine how this stuff works, there are a lot of buffers between that wire and your program. Kernel-level buffers, NIC-level buffers, operating system buffers, like user space ones, and then the implementation of your runtime probably as well. There's a very cool talk, Package Cloud, the ones that do hosted dev repositories, I think they're one of their founders did a really great talk on processing packets and how to quickly process packets and a deep dive into the way that the kernel works for this. Highly, highly recommend it. I think he mentioned it last year at Mondorama. It came out just after I had spent a lot of time doing some kernel diving in this. But the way that we do this in Veneur, the way that we make it fast, is there are a number of Go routines spun up when Veneur started. In production, we run about 96 of them, but to be honest, we haven't benchmarked it across large numbers to determine what the right one is. But we run 96 different Go routines, and when a metric comes in, we take the combination of its name, the unique number of tags in alphabetical order, the type of metric, and we hash that and then mod it across the 96 different Go routines. We dispatch it to one of those 96. That way, since we're dealing with a very large breadth of metrics, I think we have about 2.5 million metrics, unique different metrics, that includes tags, I believe. That means that in a given 10-second period, there's a lot of breadth to it. We're not contending for each one of those workers at any given time. We're spraying it around. There are certain, it's not fully balanced because there are definitely more of one metric than there are of another, but it works pretty well. We also in Veneur have an implementation of, so by default, Golang's ability to have multiple readers on a socket is limited by the fact that it does not support SO reuse port. If you're not familiar with that, it's a thing that says that multiple processes can read from a given port at the same time, thereby lowering the speed, because if your processor can't read fast enough, the buffer fills up, and when the buffer fills up, packets just get dropped on the floor. So we hopefully mitigate some of that. If you are not on a platform that supports this, we just don't work. We do work, we just don't use it. We just skip right out of it, so no worries. This is what Veneur looks like today. So we run Veneur. All of the hosts, forgive the fact that only one of those lined up, but it would have looked terrible if I'd drawn lines all the way over there. So we've got each of these three Veneurs that are each making their local decision. The host that is sending the metrics in, the service that's running or whatever, is completely agnostic. It just sprays metrics at the local host. This machine has a Veneur running on it, which sends one of the metrics, it either sends the metric to Datadog or it sends the metric to Veneur, if it's a global metric. So it does this by type. It says, well, if this is a timer or if this is a set or a histogram, then I'm going to send it to the global Veneur. Otherwise, I'll just send it to Datadog. So this means that we're doing routing. So we, in Veneur itself, look at all these different metrics and we make a decision as to where it should go based on its type. I'll talk more about other things other than type at the bottom, but basically counters and gauges accrue locally, and then those get posted directly from each host to Datadog. Now, we use a proxy internally for egress filtering reasons, they all get routed through a set of AJ proxies. Histograms, timers, and sets accrue locally, but then we take that T-digest implementation or that hyperlog log, and we send that to the global Veneur via HTTP post. And then those all get merged for an additional 10 seconds and then flush the data. Lastly, you can also, if you're interested, override these behaviors through magic tags by saying Veneur local only, which even if it's timer, histogram, or set, will only keep it local and then ship it directly to data. Or Veneur global only, which has the opposite effect. Now, globally doing gauges makes no sense because that would just be last write wins, but counters, this does make a little bit of sense. We specifically use that mostly to bring down tag cardinality. So one of the things that I'm sure you're familiar with Graphite or with Datadog in a set in a tag-based system is if you you start off with your cool Graphite schema and you got a bunch of stuff, and then one of them down here is like host and then CPU core or something like that, and pretty soon you've got 1,000 hosts and each of them have 16 cores, and now you've got 16,000 metrics that you didn't realize you were going to have. Same problem here. Some of our metrics we've decided we want them to be global just to tamp down how many different tags are on them, and it adds like a sometimes a couple of order of magnitude reduction in tag cardinality, which for anybody building one of these things, the metric cardinality or the tag cardinality, each generally speaking, whether it's Graphite or tags in a tag-based system, the number of unique combinations of tags or metric names is how many time series you generate. And that quickly becomes very bad because if you're like, oh, I just want to average the CPU consumption across all the cores on all my 1,000 hosts, that's now 16,000 time series that have to be averaged, summed, or whatever it is that you're trying to do. So we use this as a way to mitigate that. But we get the best of both worlds from this, right? We get host local consumption, no drops, because all of this UDP packet stuff is being done to the local host. We specifically love this. I mean, if you've read The Art of Monitoring, then the whole like push versus pull thing can pretty easily be settled by some of those conversations. The whole fire and forget metrics thing is maybe not awesome because like you could drop some, but we spray out so many of them, I'm okay with the occasional drop. But more than that, the fact that it's all local this way means that it's fairly easy on us operationally. We don't have to scale any big box to handle a lot of packets or anything. It's also very simple to reason about in this way. It's like my metrics come out and they go right here. There are some really fun things that I think we can do with this in the future. I didn't put this in the bright future section that's at the end of this talk. But one of the things that's nice about this is especially in like a Docker world or something like that. Do you have a question?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm a little confused. So you just said every host has its own local veneur,
yeah.
But then there's the global one, so doesn't the UDP problem occur in the global?
All post after that, HTTP after that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, let me back up. I probably should have put protocols here. So this bit is all UDP local.
Right.
But after you get out of this, everything that you're seeing here is UDP. Or sorry, HTTP.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry. That's a really good question. So all very easy to reason about. Everything happens on the local host. We also have the cool part of this that we know the origin of these metrics, which is really nice. Like when you have a stats thing, you could like look at the incoming IP address and relate some stuff, but we have the ability that since every host has its own veneur, we can change the tags on it. We can like sort of decorate it with additional information. We know the original source of the metric, which maybe if you happen to run in like a Docker environment where that host is or that instance is specifically meant to run a service, then you can tell the origin and like trace it all back. We have designs, I think, at some point to build out like a secondary index from this, so we can say like here is the metrics that came from your stuff, and give you like a catalog of the metrics that make sense to you. And you know, now in this world, we've got useful global percentiles and sets. We have a very fixed sort of story around the resource usage of our own instances. This is a very nice world that we live in. And by this world, I mean this one, with the global. So again, to recap all this, again, great question. I'm sorry this was not clear earlier on, but all the local hosts, in fact, there's probably like a series of boxes you put down here that's like service on the box. Because all these are just using, to use the point made earlier, this is just the local stats feed. Thing. So every programming language you can think of these days has a dog statsd implementation, which is basically just the statsd library with tags. We internally, another thing that we offer to Stripe as a product is that we maintain all of the dog statsd libraries because we've made better ones and added new primitives and stuff like that. So, begin shining. Well, first off, let me stop right here for a moment, make sure there are no other questions of things that I explained poorly about this, since I left that one out. Any other questions before I tell you the shiny future we're all going to live in the future, where this is even awesomer?
Oh, you mentioned that you use the compression. Mm-hmm. So, did you do some test that you just use the compression? Is there some improvement for package jobs?
There is some, because the global instances, the only place that we're using compression, we don't compress inside of stripes in of the pipeline. We only compress on the Datadog leg of the post. And it's really only because at that point we've accumulated a lot of metrics in one body. It is definitely faster, but because we now break it up into multiple smaller bodies, how much faster it is I'm not sure we've bothered with measuring.
I'm not very familiar with that, but we are using Promise,
mm-hmm.
and before we didn't do the compression,
mm-hmm.
we had the package jobs.
Yeah.
But for our current workload, actually, we just did compression.
Mm-hmm.
It works fine. So
nice. Well, and another, assuming MTU doesn't break you, there are also some libraries that support buffering statsd packets, and then you can send them all in one big chunk, and that has a huge, so it's basically buffering, but it has a huge positive effect on some instances. So that's a good point that another mechanism there is both either compression or batching of again, MTU can be a problem, especially if you're on the public internet, but within your own infrastructure, sometimes that works. But MTU scares me, because it's usually what's wrong, like in almost all situations.
One question.
Yeah.
So packets get dropped when you exceed the UDP receive buffer. I haven't really looked into it, but is it possible to raise that? Maybe would you have to compile a custom kernel? Or?
No, you can. So it is an option to the system call to create the socket. You can say, like, make it really big. Veneur is, I think, default to something like 16 megabytes just to try to give it some room. But the difficulty is that when you're... So in early tests, we were able to take about 150,000 packets a second. Which is definitely more than plain old statsd can do, and seems roughly compatible with like what a Brubeck can do. The problem is that it doesn't matter anymore, because one NIC can't generally handle more than that. In an AWS world, if you're running your own, then NICs all have like configurable buffer sizes that you can adjust. If you happen to be on your own hardware, you can do things like receive packet steering. You can do IRQ load balancing across CPUs. There's like a lot of cool stuff you can do if you happen to live in a world unlike me where you can actually control the network. But since I'm working on AWS, then I can't do that.
Okay.
But yeah, there's a bunch of stuff you can do. And in fact, Veneur allows you to configure that if for some reason you were having that trouble, which I would love to hear about if you were, because we've never had that in this world, because we don't pause long enough for the buffer to accumulate.
Okay.
But even with 16 megabytes, you fill it up really fast at 150,000 packets. So shiny future, what kind of cool things we got going on? Forgive this. This is not like the other diagrams, because this is the actual one from the pull request. If you happen to look at the list of pull requests right now, there are a bunch of them. Well, not a bunch, but there's probably half a dozen adding interesting things. So a company that I know was evaluating it, and they said, you know, we really like Veneur, but we're a little bothered by the fact that there's a single point of failure. And I was like, yeah, we're going to fix that someday. And then it came up again, but in front of people, and I was like, ah, God, I've super got to fix this, because I'm sick of wandering around knowing that this is broken. So this is maybe a slightly better diagram, and then it shows that Veneur runs on a host. So this is not, we'll probably start testing, it's been tested in QA once, and it was all fine, it all works. But in an effort to employ more cool computer science stuff, what we've got here is an arrangement where Veneur's running on all the hosts, but we further sort of break this out. If any of you have ever done, like, Carbon Proxy is an implementation of this for Graphite, you've probably seen this before. There are also, there's some other ones. Stats Relay is another one that sort of does this. But basically, we run something called Veneur Proxy, which is in the Veneur code base, but generates a new binary that you run on different machines. And the idea is that you run a small number of Veneur proxy instances, however many makes sense for you, and you put those behind load balancer. The Veneur proxies are completely stateless. You send it to whichever one you want. All your different instances can post to those, and then they will take the metrics out, parse through them all, look at all the keys and sort them out, and then send them to the correct global instances behind the scenes using console to do service discovery and using a consistent hash ring so that a given metric always goes to the same box. There are some, I think the next slide is like what's not perfect about this, but this is a little more operationally challenging, right? Because there are more lines on the diagram. And as we all know, every one of those lines is actually many headings. And so this is a little fancier, but if you've dealt with something like Carbon Proxy in your work, it's not really anything dissimilar from that. Yeah?
We're using Carbon Server, which is one of the projects that Booking.com created while we were there for the carbon transport back in. It's very similar to this. Basically, the nodes say send any metric to any one of these instances. So we don't have a load balancer in the middle. Mm-hmm. Just basically the host makes that decision. If the metric successfully lands, it's over TCP, obviously. If it gets a successful send, then it drops that metric from the queue, and if not, it'll continue queuing metrics until those individual points come
back. It's like a slightly smarter client, but in a good way, not in the obtusely scary way that I was describing earlier.
Yeah, basically, it's just the Carbon protocol, and it's localhost 2003, mm-hmm. and then you just anything that writes graphite writes to localhost 2003, and then it gets to the endpoints that it needs to go automatically.
And if you look at the pull requests that are active right now for Veneur, there's actually two that do this. The first one is Veneur is smart enough to do all of this on the local host. We ended up pulling it out, and I think this is mostly for Stripe's purposes, because we have a sort of Envoy-esque, like, we have a bunch of load balancers that sort of like handle different parts of our infrastructure. And for us, the idea of setting up a load balancer and then a bunch of instances behind it is like how we scale. So this is shaped very much the way that Stripe functions. But that is also a very valid way to do it. We could build like a little bit smarter, but also a little bit smarter Veneur, but not as smart as what these proxies are currently doing, that basically sort of like handled getting it to the right place. You also raise a good point that there's nothing in Veneur anywhere that, like, if they don't get it, like, there's no ACK. Like, even the HTTP stuff is basically, if it fails, it's fine, because losing one metric for 10 seconds, we generally don't consider to be that bad. It's a very stats-D sort of view of the world. again, this is console. Actually, I think the next slide. Yeah. So Veneur proxy runs between locals and globals. You can send to anything, we're pretty happy with the make the clients as dumb as possible, because it's really nice to be able to say you can send this to any box, we don't mind. Makes the clients, we very rarely have to update clients anymore, which we're pretty happy with. It unpacks the metrics, like the whole body, and then breaks them up into buckets and then sends them out to their respective destinations via HTTP post. And it periodically refreshes the console list. So this is totally not a new idea, as was pointed out here. That's good, though, because we're not inventing some crazy new thing, right? Like, this is basically all of what I've described tonight is effectively like, well, in StatsD, we solved a bunch of these problems. Now here we're solving them, just updated a little bit with some new practices we've learned, things like tags or, you know, whatever else. Like, it's basically just a modern form of something we've done in the past. And there are, as was described, other Carbon implementations, which I'm familiar with, and probably other, I know that, another company nearby us uses Wavefront, and they use Stats Relay and a couple of other things that are basically very similar. It only uses console for now. This isn't merged either. This is, again, bright future. Patches are welcome if you use Zookeeper or something like that. You could do service discovery whatever way. It's actually implemented as an interface, so you can do it however. And it's very simple. Our first version of this was that Veneur itself, like every machine in the fleet, went to console and asked constantly how many console instances there were. And our team that runs console was like, that's really cool. Don't do that. Please run this on a smaller number of instances. And I was like, oh yeah, that's totally how I should do it. We also have some other backends that work today. You don't even have to do any patches. It doesn't replace Datadog, it's supplemental to it. But you can write this out in FluxDB. If you do use it, please let me know, because I've only used it at home for a small number of metrics and it worked great, but maybe it doesn't work for larger things. It might send 45 megabyte post bodies. There's also a patch. Sorry, it's still a patch and isn't merged yet. But there is a patch to basically wire Go metrics in, and that gives you freedom to use any of the backends that Go metrics support, which is a much larger list than the one that we have, which is basically only influx. If you're not familiar with Go metrics, it's basically a full-on metrics library for you to instrument your running service, but it has backends that let you send it to basic. I don't even know what all it is, but it's a big list, a lot of things. So this one is currently still in the patch stages. This is simultaneously an explanation for you in person and for anyone listening along, which is that currently this is all stuff that's like wired in after we flush the Datadog. And ultimately what we want this to be is something where even Datadog is implemented as just one of the destinations. And so instead of it being a very Datadog-centric tool, we want all of the backends to basically be equal, and then you can just pick as many of them as you want to run. So a couple of good benefits to this, namely that we've become now vendor agnostic, that you don't have to be using Datadog. Just like I think tag-based stuff is cool, and there are very few like vendor-agnostic protocols for sending metrics, and so we've basically turned DogStatsD into one. And then you can run more than one backend simultaneously, so you could run Datadog, but also maybe evaluate Influx or send things to Prometheus or whatever it is that you'd like to do. Patches are completely welcome on all of this. We do run this thing in production, but we basically merge ahead of ourselves, so we're actually not running the current version a couple of patches ahead, the TCP stuff. We'll probably patch production sometime in the next week or so, but it hasn't changed much, so I think we'll be fine. This is probably one of the first times this has come outside of Stripe. We are also working on tracing. In fact, Veneur is completely wired up for open tracing today, and it is tracing itself. So this whole process where we take metrics locally and then send them downstream and then flush them to Datadog, we're doing distributed tracing throughout. The tracing stuff that is out today, like there's a couple different, like open tracing, how many of you know about open tracing? Cool. So open tracing is a client implementation that then can use pluggable backends to send traces to Zipkin, Lightstep, a couple of other things. We are currently tracing ourselves, but you can, although nothing's really using it today, send trace packets via UDP, which is a little weird. Nobody does this but us that I'm aware of. I've never seen anybody do it. For us, because we're working in a Ruby world, there are very, very few things that we want to put into background threads and then happen in background. And almost nothing can happen synchronously here. So in our UDP packets, we've been for our metric packets, we've been doing those via UDP. And for our trace packets, we've been designing doing the same thing. So we have this like rough UDP protocol that we have today for being able to send trace packets. And since we're doing that on the local host, MTU is not really a concern. If we had to do this across the actual wire, that would probably be a problem. But internally, there is an open tracing API. We are tracing ourselves. It works. And we're marginally happy with it. But we haven't deployed it to the world yet. Which leads me, any questions about tracing? Yeah.
Well, where do you send it to? What's the tool you use?
So Datadog had recently announced a tracing tool. It supports that, but it's, and that's actually the only backend that it kind of works with today, but that's not where we plan to stop. It's just we haven't interfaced it enough yet to send it to anywhere else. We might send it to Lightstep. We're talking to them. Maybe we'll send it there and see how it works. My team runs the pin at Twitter, so I'm definitely into the idea of doing it. And I think that it provides the tracing in general, I think, is going to be really valuable for us in between logging and metrics. Like there's this like gulf in here, you know, like the dashboards all say something's wrong. Nobody's telling us what it is, and I wish I knew. And that's where we end up going to Splunk most of the time.
You mentioned because of your Ruby stuff, you don't do a lot of background processes.
No, we're so threads in Ruby. We have some very, very We have a very small subset of things we allow that to happen with. Okay. We, of course, have tons of deferred work queue type stuff, but they're generally not super time sensitive for us.
Are you talking, like, we use Rescue for a lot
of things? Yeah, we have Rescue for some things. I mean, I think we've got them all somewhere or another, but in the Ruby land, it's mostly. Actually, on the Stripe built an entire, so if you ever used Stripe before as a customer, things like webhook delivery, like, we will basically, we have like this contract with you that will like try a number of times over some period or something like that. All that stuff is a deferred work queue that's built custom in-house. So we use that for most stuff. But there's that small number of things that you want to happen asynchronously within one transaction, but they're not mission critical, which is what tracing would fall into. And we don't really have that. Sending errors to Sentry is probably the only thing that we really do that on. And that's actually the only, one of the very few threaded asynchronous things we do in our Ruby stack today. I mean, if anybody from Stripe that knows more about this than me, they'd probably have another list, but that's the one I know about. Was there another question about tracing? Great. So, StatsD and DogStatsD are pretty cool, but I wish I could have all of my life back wherein we have spent it chasing weird string bugs and parsing StatsD packets. So another thing that is in Veneur, if you go mucking around in Veneur, you're going to find a lot of weird code paths where we're trying things out. One of them here is a protobuf-based metrics format that represents all of the different possible primitives one can have and send to Datadog. We have this running joke at Stripe that we're eventually going to make like a monoidal time store where you can like store all of the things in one type of database instead of having a time series database and a trace database and a log database and an event database and like all these other things that are all stored separately, because my end users don't really care. My end users want to be able to put all this data in and look at it all and get this signal, and we end up having to build these separate, distinct tools because the backends for them are all different. We're not really using any. We have some proof of concepts that do everything from tracing to logging all in like one Ruby program. But effectively, like take protobuf and design like gauges, timers, counters, sets, trace spans, like all these other things. They all actually are sort of shaped similar. Like a trace span with an error that also happens to clue, that has a time duration in it, is very similar to a timer. And so basically, if you squint at it hard enough, we've convinced ourselves that these actually look very similar. I would not be surprised if in a year or so, our packets are not strings. They are protobuf that are implementing all this stuff over UDP. We're not sure about that yet, but it's out there, and it's pretty cool. And it's in there. There's a protobuf file that defines our metric format that we're not actively using right now, but we're iterating on it and playing with it. Another thing, we have a load and fault team at Stripe that basically it's their job to load test and introduce failure and basically torture the stack. I've been talking with them a lot lately because Datadog is all secondly metrics, which is an improvement over my time at Twitter, which was minutely. But we still only flush every 10 seconds. That 10 seconds suddenly becomes worse if you also send it as a histogram, which means it's 20 seconds. But then there's all delays. Like if you fall just on the front side of a clock tick, like, that was even more delay. And, you know, sometimes there's like an HTTP delay. Worst case, you can see a minute and a half delay in getting metrics all the way to Datadog. Most of that is governed by the fact that Datadog's dashboards only update once a minute. And so you can sometimes miss a tick and it'll be as bad as two. But everyone wants their stuff to show up faster. So there's some crazy hacks we've built or tried, which are like, well, the globals can write out to files. So if you like tail the file and grep it, you can get your metrics out. There's also a patch that is in my downloads folder when I sent it to myself before I got on the plane that allows you to open a WebSocket and connect to it, and it will stream the metrics to whatever's watching. So you can, like, as the metrics are received and flushed, it will immediately send them to your WebSocket. This is really handy if, like, Datadog is down or your time series database or whatever is down. You can just connect to one of these instances and let it send you the metrics directly. That way you sort of circumvent whatever it is that's broken. It also drastically lowers the latency. If I could go back in time, I would probably adjust this to a 5-second flush instead of a 10. But as anyone who's bothered to poke at this knows, the like data is often stored as a rate with the flush period in it, which means it multiplies them, so you can't ever change the metrics after you've written them once because you break them all. But anyway, I would really like them to be faster. So if you have cool ideas for how we could maybe get metrics out faster, I'd love to see pull requests. Or I mean, you can open issues, but that's sending code is much less annoying than telling you to make it faster. So thank you for listening to me do this poorly organized talk. By myself, I mean, not by the organizer. Thanks to all the observability folks at Stripe and Stripe in general for letting me play with all this stuff. Again, I mean, this was something I put together as like a project at night off the clock, and then I brought it into work and showed it off, and I luckily have some peers that were like, wow, there's something cool here. And they turned it into something that I am willing to show to others. Stephen and Aditya Mukherjee, that works with me today. Stephen is back at Waterloo. He was an intern. But Aditya works with me every day and makes a ton of this stuff good. He's a very excellent Go programmer. And thanks to your friend for the invite. Thanks to you for listening. Questions? If you didn't ask them during.
Yes.
More general, but like you just explained you have experience with Datadog, like, and then you explained you have your previous experience where you manage the entire stack.
Yeah.
So is it mostly just you want to take the storage out of like your responsibilities?
Good question. So there's a couple of different aspects to this. The first is, let's see, where do I even begin? It's hard to build one of these things and run it at scale, right? So it's just, I just didn't want to do it anymore. Like my least favorite job of this is the managing of the time series database. They're very difficult to run. At one point, Twitter ran the largest Cassandra cluster in the world just for time series. It was a huge cost thing for us, I know this is approximately right, but it was something like 99% of the metrics that were written by our customers, so the customers being the engineers of Stripe, were never read out of the database. So like 99% of this multi-million-dollar cluster to run time series database was just never used by anybody. But you go tell an engineer, or even yourself, that you're just not going to take some of these metrics because there's too many of them. Like you know at some point each of these metrics is probably going to be key to determining the cause of an incident or getting a service back online. So the combination of a few of those things and also just like the commoditization, like it is much easier to run a very big one than it is to run a medium-sized version of this. And personally, I didn't think that Stripe's like core competency was building time series databases. Like, our job is all about processing money and stuff, so like let's do that well and pay someone else to do the other part of the job. And I didn't really think we were big enough yet to even attempt to do that work. So we have basically pushed aside all the notion of building out a monitoring, dashboarding, or time series storage. So that's why we've leaned on Datadog, Signal Effects or Librato or whomever you could put in that bucket would all probably be suitable backends. Like there's not anything special. I mean, I happen to like a lot of the products, and I know a lot of the people that work there, but that's just a bias. It's no objective reason. Any other thoughts?
Questions? I was wondering if you can go over, like, on a very high level, like, we use Splunk for. Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, sure. The fun answer is that so when I joined Stripe, I already told you, like, really old graphite version, dropping a ton of StatsD stuff. Many of you are probably going, well, why were you even using it? And that's a great question. Like, why were we using it? Because it was totally inaccurate. There were, like, four dashboards anybody gave a shit about, and even those were mostly wrong. So basically for a couple of years, they didn't have any real time series metrics to speak of. They got by using Splunk. When I worked at Twitter, there was no log indexing at all. They seem to have some of that now, but it was completely a metric-based system. If you've know anything about Finagle, their RPC framework and everything, very heavily instrumented, lots of metrics, every instance can be pulled metrics from, very friendly to a Prometheus environment where you go and pull those metrics down. But at Stripe, it was basically that model on its head. It's like, no, let's just log everything. And so they had like, something, I forget what it was, and then they set up like an Elk stack. They're not really, at the time they weren't really much of a JVM shop. Like there's a very big JVM arm of Stripe now, but at the time they were a Ruby shop. And so anyone who's run Elk and Anger knows that you need to know a thing or two about JVMs and how to tune them. And so they had a bad experience with Elk, so they went back to Splunk. And Splunk, I mean, it's expensive and it has a learning curve, but it is very operationally worky. Like it works pretty well. If you keep it, you know, like fed and watered, it like works every day. And so there's a concept called, I mean, I don't know what other people call it, but internally we call them splunk lines, but they're basically a unique string that identifies various operations within the stack. So like every API call at Stripe outputs a splunk line. It says something like canonical API line as unique, that those bytes always occur. And then everything else after that is named value pairs. So it's effectively an event, right? And basically with that, if you're armed with that information, you can write some crazy cool stuff on top of that using Splunk. And you can generate time series data. And if you don't have a ton of engineers that are all clamoring to look at it at the same time, it scales pretty well. Like Splunk has a limit to the number of queries you can run simultaneously. But which, by the way, so do other systems. They just don't bound them in any way.
Right.
Splunk actively bounds them so that if you hit it, it doesn't start to perform poorly. It just kicks you out. And so effectively Splunk was, to this day, it's our Canary dashboard. So if you deploy to the Canary, because Splunk refreshes faster than our metrics do, we use that as our signal for whether the fleet is healthy. And then the general kind of API health dashboard is all done.
Because I'm just trying to understand it in terms of like the stack I use at the startup I work for. So would like Rollbar and Sentry be equivalent there or not?
So we use Sentry separately. So Sentry, you could do Sentry stuff with Splunk, but it doesn't provide the ability to easily consume an exception and like remove unnecessary frames and give you that pretty picture around an exception the way that Sentry does. A big question for us when we started using Datadog originally was why would I use this instead of Splunk? And which maybe is kind of where your question is at, like where
yeah,
is
like
the...
I'm basically trying to say,
yeah.
If I were to go back and say, I want to use Splunk, I'm
yep.
just trying to find where that piece of the puzzle would fit in.
Well, like, we're having this discussion right now on Craigslist because we have StatsD and Graphite, and it's like, well, why do we need Elasticsearch? And it's, we're not using Splunk, we have a very strict requirement to keep all of the data on our own servers. We have no cloud-based providers whatsoever.
We run Splunk on-prem. We run Splunk on-prem.
It's almost like the metrics that you have in Datadog are going to be, first off, numeric data that you store in an event store or a key value store. So those are things that are consumed at a regular interval that you have regularity to. Splunk would be more for event-based data, for log data, even possibly even trace data. I don't know if it's
yeah, you can do that. There's a command called transaction that you can give it like a unique string and it will thread them together temporarily. It's not the same as what you would see in a dedicated tracing tool, but you can. We got by with it for a long time.
Okay.
So, go ahead.
Well, I was going to ask just generally about how do you actually, since you're in the lead of the observability team, sorry, I'm a bit tired.
Me too, buddy. plane ride this morning, 2-hour time difference.
Crying baby for me. but basically, how do you guys actually run your monitoring? So do developers only interact with monitoring through StatsD, or like who kind of deploys the agent, configures your database monitoring, all that kind of stuff? Do you guys do that, or is it?
So I think we have a slightly, I'm very biased by the world I live in at Twitter. Twitter weaponized my interest in monitoring and observability, so most of my biases come from that. It was a very self-serve environment. Kind of built your own stuff. It was awesome because like you could invest as much time in it as you wanted, but it was not awesome because I don't think we were as customer oriented as, by customer what I mean is like I treat every engineer at Stripe as if it's my job to make them happy, right? Like mm-hmm. they are my customer. And so we basically do what you said. The observability team basically owns the pipeline. Mm-hmm. So we own the interfaces. We say that we support DogStatsD. While we're at it, we even maintain all the clients. Mm-hmm. So we'll build clients for your runtimes. We thread them through the monolith so that they're already there. You don't have to worry about it. We write those APIs for you. Like not a client library, mm-hmm. but the API. We have a lot of different like convenience features. Like managing sample rates is hard. Like everybody just wants to set it at 100. So we've got increment, which everyone knows from StatsD-ish type libraries. But we created another one called Increment Abnormal, which is like, this is something that doesn't happen very often, so please sample it more often, but I'm going to hide the real... It's really 100, but we have it in our own knob, so we can twist it down if somebody does something bad. So we own everything from that, like, how do I instrument, all the way through to the experience that you have when you're setting up a monitor or a dashboard. So by leveraging Datadog, we, like, amplify our ability to produce a decent product for them. Like, you know, running Grafana or something, like, whatever, you can open source that, but, like, it's you're still at the will of the open source community. At Datadog, we pay them so they, you know, develop the features that we want. We don't have to have a big staff. Like, my team is six or seven people. I forget, I'd have to stop and count. That would be embarrassing. So, 6 or 7 people, but, you know, we interface, like, if you have a problem, if you came to me and said, this monitor is not really doing what I want, I can't get it to quite work, we will come sit with you and fix it for you.
Okay.
And then, so basically all the parts of the stack, we do that. If you've got a dashboard that one somebody on your team made and nobody can figure out what it means, we come do that for you. If you can't figure out how to instrument something because it's odd, we come and do that for you too. So we're basically, it's like going, you know, gas stations used to be full service sometimes. Like, we're a full service observability shop. So we basically, we bring all these Sentry, Splunk, Datadog, all these tools, we build them that, you know, we make them a good experience for our engineers.
And do the engineers also set up, like, database monitoring by themselves and stuff like that?
Most of that stuff we are frameworked or monolithed enough that we can provide a lot of that stuff for them,
okay.
If that's what you mean. Now, for our, like, the storage teams that manage our databases, like, we work closely with them in the same way I described. So, like, they've got a more purpose-built kind of thing that they need, mm-hmm. and so we work with them to try to, like, create a good setup for that, and we're getting better about building out monitoring that is more tailored. Like, you shouldn't have to build your own monitors to know if your hard drives are full. So that stuff, we have a thing internally that called automated monitoring, which is basically productized certain monitors that you should just know, and they're all wired into Jira, so we automatically create tickets for you that get put into Stripe has a thing called Run, which is not being on call. It's like business hours on call. And so we dispatch tickets that you're expected to handle during your run rotation that say, like, hey, this box OOM'd. You probably should do something about that. Or your hard drive is full. You should probably fix this. Or your service has been, like, doing that thing where it restarts every 30 seconds for, like, the last 2 days. You should probably go clean that up. So we basically build a lot of that stuff as – that raises the water level for all the boats. So we try to deploy those for everyone. And I think in the future we would like to wire up our service discovery and sort of, like, service deployment stack so it, like, traces even more of those things back to their roots and gives you notification of those. But effectively, it's like if you had a full stack that you offered as a product to people, we do that just for Stripe. Mm-hmm. Because I think that in my past lives, the companies that did this, like, they just sort of threw it over a fence and said, mm-hmm. figure it out. And that doesn't make for good monitoring. It makes for, like, just enough. It makes for whatever managers say you have to have. I mean, we use Datadog's tools for it. We also run Nagios for, like, the 5 things we can't figure out how to represent any other way. But we'll probably get rid of that too. Basically everything from log indexing, exceptions, time series, and monitoring all the way from instrumentation all the way to monitoring of the or alerting. Datadog calls them monitors. Alerts are what happen when monitors go bad. Sorry, that's just dumb terminology that's stuck in my head. So we basically represent that whole stack. Like, it's your team's responsibility to deal with your alerts, like setting them up and actioning them. But we provide things like best practices, and, you know, soon we're going to start linting everybody's monitors. Like, you don't have a link to a runbook here. What are you doing? Or we also want to get into the analytics of, like, how often you're firing. So under the auspices of my manager, we also, like, the incident stuff is also a part of a sister organization of mine. So another team, there's not really anybody on it yet, but when there is, it's just one person right now, but basically we'll start to formalize some of those. And, like, I mean, I also want to know, like, which of your alerting is performing poorly, where's the toil coming from in your on-call rotation? Like, we want to get into that stuff too and provide you with analytics about that, because that tells me where we need to go help. Because if you're, like, getting woken up a lot, I don't want to know about that when your people start quitting your team. I want to know about that, like, months ahead of time, so that we can get in there and teach you how to monitor this more effectively or make your items more actionable. trait, to go back to a question, I know you had a question, and I'll come back to it in a second. The question about Splunk, like, there's a weird gulf between time series database and logs. I would like to shore some of that up. To me, tracing is kind of the thing that's going to help us bridge that gap. Like, time series database, as I think you alluded earlier, are approximations. They're like this, like, decimated, untraceable set of, like, aggregates that we did every 10 seconds. And it's really tricky to know how to tie that back to a metric, or I'm sorry, back to a log event. But I think tracing provides a nice, like, middle ground between the two of these, because a trace is just a sample of some of the full set, like the full number of things that happened to make a request be serviced. And so I'm hoping that when we get tracing spun up, we'll pull some people out of the Splunk world over into tracing and then decrease some of our reliance on Splunk is the goal, I think. I think it makes for a better product because it's very difficult to teach everyone how to Splunk. It's a power tool, right? And like, well, actually, it's not even a power tool. It's like, it's not like the kind of tool you bring home. It's the kind of tool you rent, you know, that you have to like rent a trailer and a truck to get it home. Like, yeah, you need your neighbor to come over and help you get it out. I just recently aerated my lawn. I might be bitter. An aerator for a yard is not something you use every day. It's something you use when there's a problem. And so what I want people, the way I see it is, metrics are where you go to determine how things are doing. Tracing is where you go when you see an aberration and you want to investigate it. And logs are where you go when you know approximately what's wrong, but you need to see the actual instances of it. So and they become increasingly more expensive down the pipe. Because like logs, you retain everything for a long period of time. Traces is still decimated, like it's still maybe a tenth of your traffic, but then metrics are like this like really bad brown smear of like something that happened around this time. And so like each one of them is progressively better as you work your way down, but also more expensive.
Is some recommended tracing tool available now?
Not really. No, it's still kind of the Wild West. Wait for Monitorama. I hear there's a lot of distributed tracing talks coming out right now. Zipkin is open source and you can get it today. Lightstep is a commercial product that's out there. New Relic has a tracing tool, although I think it's a little less general purpose. Datadog has a beta version of tracing that's available. So there's a few of them floating around. I don't know a lot about any of their implementations yet, though. The ones I've seen, we ran Zipkin and like four engineers at Twitter thought it was the most awesome thing ever and used it, and everyone else kind of ignored it. But those four people were wizards. Like, they could just summon amazing data and just blow everybody's mind. So it was more about getting the tool palatable for everybody to use, I think. I'm sorry, I'm going to let you ask your question.
Yeah, more along dashboarding and letting people create their own dashboards and everything. You may not even have this requirement, all being within Stripe. When people are allowed to make dashboards, so they have access to all of the data underneath. So you just have everything.
Yep, it's all out there. I mean, one of the upsides of using Datadog stuff is we can pretend like they're not part of our, like, I don't have to deal with the sharding that we have to deal with internally, like the separate zones and stuff. They are still subject to AWS problems because I happen to know Datadog runs on AWS. I will say, though, that like that's one of the things that kind of bothers me is that when they come in and they look at their metrics, they're not limited to seeing the metrics that are in their context. They see every metric in the universe, which is a little much, good and bad. Generally, we've gotten into the habit of prefixing metrics by service name for some things, and that helps a ton. And generally, the search is not prefix based. Datadog does not allow wildcards, so it's more easy to just like the very short names. So if your service is named foo, then when you start typing foo dot, like it, you pretty quickly hone in on it. So I haven't found it to be too much of a problem. But what I have a problem with is people knowing what is even available because the list is so large. It quickly turns them off. So that's going back to like understanding like where the origin of these metrics were and who I am and what my services are. If any of you have been in the phase of life that Stripe is in where we're not little and we're not huge, you know there's like this big transition and we must actually own things and know who is the directly responsible individual. For all of this stuff, and so that's something we're doing internally right now, and then we'll tie. Like, one of the things I love about working in the observability team is that we are effectively, like, in the middle of all the stuff. Like, I could go work on any one team, but instead I get to see what all of them are doing and try to figure it out. So we take like the ownership stuff and we figure out how to wire that in. And then we've got incident response, which is directly related to making my customer's experience at Stripe better. Something I want to get into, and that I think Veneur will help us enable in the future, is like how do I take these metrics and dial them up so that like account managers and even maybe the customers themselves get their own feed of some of this data? Like how do we take observability from being an internal cost center and turning it into like a revenue generator? Like not directly perhaps, but how do I make it so that like tentpole customers have like a very specific view? Because any of you who have run a large multi-tenant service know that a lot of times you know something's broken because that customer tells you, because it's easier for them to monitor you than it is for you. There you go. Yeah. So like how do I know that it's broken for that one customer, you know? And so when Lyft has got a problem, Lyft tells us, and I want to get in a world where we are more proactively able, or better yet, when their account manager or whomever doesn't have to come, like, do that dance where they're like, hey, engineers, is something broken? You know, like, I hate that dance. It sucks. And, I mean, I feel bad for them because this is dumb. They shouldn't have to ask that way, you know? And we should know. I was asked to help a fairly high-profile customer in Q3 of last year, and it made me so sad to see them spot something before we saw it. So I want to figure out how we can like sort of come over these cardinality rules or cardinality problems and build something where we can track each of these customers. I have some ideas, and I think that in the next year we'll tie it all together. I also have some ideas for how to make metrics work with traces, work with logs, and make that whole.
We have a lot of data implementations for it.
I will probably add to it, but we'll iterate.
It takes a lot more manpower than you would think. We have like 30 neural systems.
Yeah.
We have HP, Xenos, Graphite, everything you can think of. So modernizing that.
I used to work on AS400s. So.
Yeah, we have those.
Yeah, it's still in very active use in a lot of places.
I saw one the other day.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Since you mentioned you have some Graphite in there, I'm a Graphite, a bit of a Graphite fanboy. There's some projects that I know all the stuff the Pokemon is working on.
Sorry.
Cut recording.
They have a complete Go stack for the carbon.